What a huge difference there is between the 16th century and now. A world without cars, trains, planes, and not a ping of a mobile phone. How did they cope? 500 years ago, the city of Plymouth was a profoundly different place. It was a small village overlooking a seemingly uneventful ocean. But things were about to change. Seamen from Portugal and Spain had accidentally redrawn the shipping routes for the entire world when they discovered the Americas, the Pacific, and the Cape of Good Hope. Plymouth was catapulted from a sleepy backwater into a launch pad for international trade. This medieval hamlet transformed into a busy trading port, a global centre of voyage, a naval base for two world wars, and now, today, home to a quarter of a million people. Plymouth has seen its fortunes rise and fall, but it stands today a 21st century city with a unique story. A civil engineering story on a scale that's hard to comprehend. From our present-day vantage point, it might be difficult to appreciate just how important civil engineers have been to Plymouth. 500 years ago, the world was changing. Within a few years, Francis Drake had sailed around the world, Sir Walter Raleigh sent the first colonists to North America, the Spanish Armada had been defeated, and the Mayflower was on its way to the New World, all from Plymouth. Regardless of whether you were coming or going, there were simply too many ships. A packed harbour was not always a good thing. Predictably, the extreme weather conditions wrought havoc. Mindful of the growing problem, King William III ordered civil engineers to create a new dockyard. Laid out with outstanding precision and surrounded by walls and fortifications, engineers were laying the foundations for an entire town. The sheer volume of ships put pressure on all to tackle the greatest obstacle to safety, the Eddystone Rocks. The idea of a lighthouse on the most notorious reef in the English Channel was insane. Step forward, maverick architect and engineer, Henry Winstanley. Starting in the summer of 1696 and working against the weather, Winstanley's light put an end to the losses on the reef. However, during minor repairs, Winstanley and his team were dragged out to sea, never to be seen again. His lighthouse was blown away in the unforgiving storm of 1703. A wooden clad replacement by John Rudyard was more successful, but it wasn't fireproof, and in 1755 it burnt down, which led to the invitation to the renowned civil engineer John Smeaton to create a replacement. On the 16th of October 1759, the 24 candles of the third Eddystone Lighthouse shone out for the very first time. This incredible structure was 72 feet tall, fireproof, and ingeniously constructed from interlocking stones. By the end of the 1700s, Plymouth's military presence had also grown, with large new barrack blocks and naval and military hospitals of pioneering design. Everyone in England knew Plymouth by name and how it was helping to transform the country's fortunes. Unfortunately, no one had yet addressed the savage westerlies whistling straight into the Plymouth Sound. Many ships had been wrecked and lives lost around Mountbatten, the Hoe, and Sutton Pool. This was painfully exemplified in 1796, when a ship called the Dutton smashed onto the rocks. It was carrying over 500 people. A permanent breakwater was needed. The powers that be looked to engineers as they sought to protect the future of Plymouth Sound. It actually took two generations of the Rennie engineering family before it was finally completed in 1848. Its unconventional bent shape is a great example of how engineers work with the natural elements rather than against them. Even Napoleon Bonaparte was impressed when he was brought to Plymouth Sound as a prisoner. It's claimed that he remarked he understood why France lost to a country capable of such engineering magnitude. Plymouth Dock was becoming huge. It was renamed Devonport in 1824, as Sir John Rennie began to plan, with Philip Richards, the construction of the then state-of-the-art Royal William Yard. Up until this point, the supremacy of the sea had been paramount in Plymouth's evolution. But the 19th century had arrived, and the age of steam power provided a new challenge. Let us introduce the great Isambard Kingdom Brunel. Unfazed by the hills and rivers in his way, he brought his Great Western Railway to Plymouth and on into Cornwall by 1859. His ambitious scheme required perseverance and real engineering talent with viaducts and bridges, not to mention tunnels that broke through hills to connect the peninsula to Exeter and beyond. Brunel also built the Great Western Docks at Mill Bay to link these rail passengers to steamships. This was a big deal. Perhaps the most impressive part of the railway is the Royal Albert Bridge that crosses the Tamar. This was and still is the largest tubular arch bridge ever constructed. The arrival of the train helped transform the economic potential of the Southwest. Plymouth was now well and truly connected. It's a lot to take in. Plymouth was growing. Yet the single largest construction project of the 19th century hadn't even begun. Convinced that the French were considering a major assault, the protection of the three towns became a matter of national concern in the 1860s. The result? One of the most formidable sets of military forts and defences ever constructed. Engineers built a chain of 25 fortifications from Tregantle in Cornwall to Staddon Heights in Devon. The remarkable Breakwater Fort completed the circuit. The project took 12 years to complete. The naval dockyard was also extended to accommodate the late Victorian battle fleet. Civil engineers had shaped, built, and sculpted the three towns of Plymouth, and it was beautiful. The 19th century ended with another new state-of-the-art lighthouse on the Eddystone Reef. Designed by James Douglas, it's still in use today. John Smeaton's groundbreaking lighthouse was not forgotten. It was taken down and rebuilt on Plymouth Hoe, and is still an iconic landmark for the city today. The 20th century was here. The Great War had arrived with a new wave of soldiers and servicemen from across the empire. The barracks and hospitals built a century before now proved invaluable. It was a turning point. The three towns of Devonport, Stonehouse and Plymouth were forcibly amalgamated by an Act of Parliament. A city was evolving. Despite its many horrors, the war was a catalyst for the century's most important revolution, the internal combustion engine. New roads and bridges were now a necessity. War returned in 1939. By this time, Plymouth was a fully fledged city, and it was on the front line. For its size, Plymouth was the most heavily bombed city in the country. The Blitz bombs aimed to demoralise the city and devastate the dockyard. Large parts of Devonport and the city centre were razed to the ground. Rather than attempting to rebuild the past, the city planners decided on a new and ambitious plan for the future. The architect Sir Patrick Abercrombie and Plymouth City engineer James Patton Watson devised a new grid system to rebuild Plymouth's shattered infrastructure. New housing estates were added to the outskirts of the city for those who'd been bombed out of their homes. This ambitious plan for Plymouth would transform the city's look and feel. Wide streets, low buildings, and expansive promenades give Plymouth an open, clearly defined centre, while its sprawling suburban estates and parklands make it Britain's greenest city. As far as the road network was concerned, sadly, Plymouth was still a giant cul-de-sac. Roads were built to Plymouth, but only ferries could move those cars and trucks on into Cornwall. That was until the Tamar Road Bridge was opened in 1961.
On Tuesday, a new road bridge over the River Tamar will provide the main link between Devon and Cornwall.
The link would finally connect Plymouth's roads to those in Cornwall. The achievement was enormous. 20 years on, engineers built over the silted-up River Plym and connected the Tamar Bridge to one of the longest A roads in England, the A38. The people of Plymouth were now fully plugged into a national road system. Fast forward to the 21st century, it's an incredible achievement, but we're nowhere near finished. Modern civil engineering is always about sustainability. It's what they do. We are moving towards new horizons. Plymouth has thrown off the shackles of its past and is a city on the cusp of profound change. A rise in traffic saw a suspension bridge strengthened and widened for the first time anywhere in the world. Two new lanes were added outside the towers of the Tamar Bridge, cantilevered high above the estuary. The skill was unprecedented. Traffic now flows freely, unaware of this incredible feat. For Plymouth, the biggest challenge has always been about water. Freshwater, seawater, rainwater. Retrieving it, containing it, and controlling it. As Plymouth recognises the major anniversary connected to the Mayflower sailing, the Mayflower Water Treatment Works is under construction. Using the latest technologies, this will secure clean water for Plymouth well into this century. The thirst for knowledge continues at the heart of one of Plymouth's major institutions, the University of Plymouth. Established in 1862 as a school for navigation, it's now an award-winning centre for higher education and research. New flood defences are tested. New designs for extracting renewable energy from wind, waves and currents are put through their paces and coded into supercomputers. Graduates, armed with coastal and civil engineering knowledge, will embark on their own journeys working with the forces of nature. They are the civil engineers of tomorrow. Coders, programmers and analysts are being brought on board to harness the latest technologies, where engineers now collaborate with architects, scientists and artists who question the norm. We are moving towards new horizons. The pioneering civil engineers of tomorrow are exploring the future before it's built. The way things stand up, how they're built, and the stories of how they got there are fascinating. It's hard to imagine our lives without civil engineers. They were the heroes of the 19th century, and today we need them more than ever. How lucky we are living with such diverse talent to choose from to develop our city. Don't forget, as far back as the early 16th century, the mariners of Plymouth knew better than many that the world was changing. However, the pace of change and the engineering achievements that followed could never have been predicted. It should be remembered that Plymouth was a global city before anyone had even invented the term. The potential for Britain's ocean city is enormous. More than 30 towns and cities scattered across the world share its name. But this Plymouth is the mother of them all.
She's coming across now. Let's go aboard. Mr. and Mrs. Snowden, Alderman Down tells me you have a very special reason for remembering this ferry. What is it?
Oh, on Whit Sunday, just over five years ago, my son Michael was born. And I remember getting on the ferry and also when we got the other side, but in the middle, I can't remember.
What were you doing while your son was being born on this ferry?
I was having a couple of quick ones with the landlord of the Sportsman's Arms.
You haven't told us what you call him.
Oh, Stephen Michael, but we call him Michael.
Well, thank you both very much.